Thank you for giving me this opportunity. So I think a lot of things has been talked about the overloading. I'll give you a different perspective that what do the government say, like the government projects, when we approach to government or if you see the government projects in tenders, they always keep 1:1 ratio. But I'm not proposing that you should go ahead with the 1:1 ratio. What they have, they're saying that we want to be safe. We want to save this 20% design margin with the lifetime of this system. So they have a different perspective. Coming back to the overloading, we, you know, in my previous company also, in this company also, we always promote that you should go for the overloading. So as you should, you know, utilize what you have invested. But at the same time, you have to do a very critical analysis that you will incur the sum of the clipping as well as what you are getting from it. So this critical analysis you have to do on your own, then you have to make the decision whether you want to go ahead or not. In this, this is very important to choose where you are installing the system. If you are installing the system at a very good irradiance level, then you have to make a certain different decision. If you're installing at the low irradiance level, you have to make a different decision. So that depends on your system, that depends on your design capabilities, how you are going ahead with that. Another important thing which I would like to add, which everyone has already, you know, asserted that while choosing the, you know, the megawatt projects, in panels you go ahead with a lot of things, that what is the bus bar, the EVA sheet, what is the cells they are using. Why not about the inverters? Go at the component level. Ask your inverter supplier that which IGBT you are using in my system. In your inverter, which IGBT is there, which capacitor is there, which sensors are there. So these are all also very important. Like Rauf have already, you know, raised a very important thing. Ask your inverter manufacturer to get you MTBF, mean time between failure file. So this, you know, we have done a lot of R&D on the panels. Now it's time to, you know, squeeze and, you know, grill the inverter people. We'll let you know that what we are using, what we are, you know, how you, the overall thing is that we want to improvise. Innovation is the way to move forward. Quality, we can't compromise on the quality. That's all.
Principally, we seem to all agree here that, yes, overloading on the DC side is something which is going to happen. It's going to get more and more popular as the ROIs are always under pressure. I mean, in today's time, the ROIs are extremely under pressure compared to 5 years back when people were happy to see units being produced for the fun of it. So, and the second thing, do we all agree that on the AC side also it's safe enough to overload by 10%?
Basically, the AC side overloading that we are recommending or the inverter manufacturer is providing, basically it's not for the whole running period of the inverter. Basically, the AC side overloading, or if it is a 10 kilowatt inverter, if you are saying it is a 10%, the 11 kilowatt output it will be giving only at the peak time generation. It will not be for the starting from 6 in the morning to 6 in the evening.
The overloading aspect we're right now discussing is for the peak time. Whether it is DC or AC, I think that everyone understands.
Yes, when you are testing your inverter for overloading on the DC side, the same test has been carried out for doing it on the AC side. So yes, it is recommended. And when you are going for the overloading on DC side, obviously your clipping losses will also reduce, as you will be getting 10% more output on your AC side. So that advantage you are getting.
However, on the AC side, what happens practically is you inject at a certain point in the given circuit of the system. Now, whether it is drawing at that time 100% of your inverter output or 90% or 110%, it will be a variation over the period of operation.
Yes,
of the day,
correct.
Right? So that is less important to my mind. The DC side is more important because when you look at the PVSys data, and you overloaded on the DC side and kept the inverter output as 100% only, not 110 on the AC side, you still get a higher generation.
Correct.
So that is the point I think I was trying to make. I have a question. I'll ask it from the people on my left-hand side. Imagine a single line diagram and imagine a 50 kilowatt rooftop system. And I'm injecting into a three-phase panel, anywhere into a system. And the system is probably a HT system, you know, drawing power from the transformer. I have observed at times the power factor, the main power factor dropping. And it drops to a level where it gets observed, and then you have to change the point. Fortunately, we have our own power analyzers. So we keep on doing that hit and trial and seeing that, okay, this is why it happens. So I change the injection point from this to that, and it improves. But this is not directly related to inverters, but sometimes I'm suspicious that it is. Now, what are your recommendations in terms of like making sure that this mistake does not happen? The installers do it correct the first time. So do you have any observations on this yourself? Because the inverter does generate harmonics, and those could be causing problems. So I'd like to have your comments on this.
I think this question is very relevant, and not only us, I think all inverter suppliers might have seen this trend happening, where the power factor drops slightly when you install a solar power plant. Now, the main reason is very logical for this. For example, just consider a case like, for example, like you're saying, for a 50 kilowatt plant, which you are going to install in a roof, and which it is in a roof or it is in an installation area which was already having a load of, say, 1 megawatt, right, already. And now you are injecting 50 kilowatt of solar power. Now, that 1 megawatt of the load which the plant was seeking from the grid, there were both parts of the load, reactive as well as active. Consider that it was running generally at 0.95 power factor or 0.98 power factor because of the variety of the loads that the plant was having. Now, you are injecting 50 kilowatt of a solar power plant, solar power to that plant, and inverter is a device where through the firmware you can fix the power factor at which the injection has to happen. So for example, I think in all the inverters, generally the factory setting is unity power factor. So you are, so the inverter is going to inject the power at unity power factor.
That's the default factory
setting. That is the default factory setting, right. Now, there is active power 50 kilowatt that has come from solar, because of which you are importing from grid 50 kilowatt less of active power only, but the reactive power component is same. So now you consider that the ratio of active versus reactive power will skew a bit, because you are taking 50 kilowatt lesser active power from the grid, but the reactive power component is same, which means the ratio will skew, which will be seen in the form of the bill of the next month or something, where you'll see power factor going from 9.8 to 9.7. So this has nothing to do with the solar inverter solar plant is not the culprit of it. So you can, now talking about the aspect that why not to change the factory settings? Yes, it can be changed. Inverters are designed to change the factory settings or the power factor settings from unity to the bandwidth in which they can operate. But by doing this, you're actually harming the revenues which the RESCO supplier is going to get from the active power. So then what is the remedy? So the 50 kilowatt, which active power you're injecting, that part of the, to compensate for the reactive power of this component, some kind of capacitor bank needs to be installed, which will not hamper the revenues of the RESCO supplier who has put a power plant. At the same time, this will not hamper this will not create any, penalties in the electricity bill of the owner of the power plant. So unless this is done, and I think this is going to remain the same in all the plants. Now consider a case where the plant size is 500 kilowatt, and the load, original load of the plant was, solar plant is 500 kilowatt, original load of the plant was 1 megawatt. Here the ratio is going to be even more skewed. So if the power factor was, say, 0.98 earlier, it can even go to 0.95, which is going to give you much more, penalties from your grid. So for that, the first of all, through load analyzers, the load study of the load pattern and load study of the plant is must before installing a solar power plant in any roof. And after that, to mitigate that kind of reactive power requirement, already the arrangements need to be done. So these are the 2 points. And like generally, like solar inverters or solar plant is not the culprit for reducing the power factor.
For the installers, for the people who, the inverter has been purchased, the power plant has been installed. Now the point of injection has to be decided. Sometimes you do it in consultation with the customer, sometimes the customer leaves it to you. Ideally, it would be at the point, on an HT connection, it would be the point immediately after the transformer. Ideally. But suppose the transformer is a couple of, 100 meters away, you don't want to do it there. Now you have to decide that what would be the next best possible point without disturbing the power factor. So we discovered it because we had power analyzers. We have two of them in-house. So our boys knew how to handle that. But most of the installers do not use that method. So what would be the thumb rule if you had to suggest one?
I think Kishore ji has very well articulated and very well explained the thing that why it is affecting the power factor. I just want to add one little thing that capacitor bank is the solution, but the power factor is a dynamic thing. It's not a permanent one. Exactly. So new technologies are coming. Even the inverter, as you pointed out, that inverter can also supply the reactive power, but at the based off the active power. But at the same time, if the dynamic power factor is there, if the dynamic things are there, if the power factor is decreasing drastically, then go for a system where there is a dynamic reactive power supply from the inverter itself, so that you can have a closed loop and they can detect the any power factor decrease and they can supply. So in the lower ranges they supply less, and maybe in the higher range they supply more. So that is the dynamic reactive power system which today we are coming with.
I have a question to people on my right. For industrial applications, the same question I'm extending to industrial applications. Where your customer is using drives, so you have regenerative loads. Now, regenerative loads are highly unpredictable and highly variable. So how do you correct this situation? Suppose you have a customer, industrial customer with a 1 megawatt connected load, and he has a 500 kilowatt power plant on the rooftop, and he has drives. And he's using drives, and 50% of his connected load, or let's say his running load, 50% of it is coming to solar power. Now, how would you enable that this power factor at the connect point with the grid, that does not get shifted? With regenerative loads, I'm talking about.
Yeah. So, I think as our co-panelist has already explained about it, so this is something that industry is facing right now, and as an inverter supplier we are also trying to manipulate these things. And even we have done some projects wherein if we see outside India, like in Australia or USA, people are actually considering all these factors while at the design stage itself, like in terms of the power factor variations and other conditions that may vary. So in terms of the technicalities, so I think I'm not the right person for the technical thing to explain, but yeah, this is the point that is
fair enough. Yeah. Fair enough. Would you like to comment on this? Anyone else?
See, we encountered an industrial site where there were a lot of inductive and capacitive loads, where this power factor issues came up, and even though we could, put the reactive power component in the inverter, make the adjustment, but like you rightly said, at times when the loads were not there, it created a problem. And
I'm talking about the condition. You see, in today's environment, the industry is going into a very high level of automation. And as you improve your automation, the usage of drives keeps on increasing, whether it is textile or whether it is any other process industry. As the application of drives keeps on increasing, the possibilities of regenerative loads keeps on increasing, and they are variable. So your argument is good enough to handle a static condition or a condition where I know a pattern, right? But when I don't know a pattern, then how do I handle that? Because the inverter is again the one that has to play a role in this. So are there any comments or observations? So now my question is directed towards specifically regenerative loads with a lot, where you have a lot of drives in the...
See, as I have already told, that apart from the capacitor bank, this is the fixed thing, which we can't change every time. So inverter itself are coming with the reactive power compensation. So you feedback, you have to give the feedback with in terms of any PLC or any such thing, so that inverter gets the signal that what is the actual power factor, reactive power, active power is prevailing, and what do you want to achieve. It will start giving you the reactive power. Same thing Kishore has already said, that they can start providing the reactive power. There is no challenge. We can supply from 0 to 100%, we can supply.
There's a variable.
And that this is dynamic thing. We can supply maybe 10% or 20%, but that has to be, you know, you either have to choose active power, which is giving you a certain bugs, or you have to choose the reactive power.
Like Hani rightly mentioned, that like we need to choose from active or reactive power, one of them. One more point, you're talking about the dynamic reactive power, right?
Yes.
Now, in that aspect, for example, I'm talking about NGTM inverters, we have a feature where not only like from an external controller, you can control the reactive power of the inverter, but you can also control the reactive power based on the environment of the inverter. For example, by environment, I mean the voltage. We can set up that with 5% change in voltage, there should be, say, 5% increase in the leading reactive power. So it is possible even without a controller also. For example, when the reactive power changes, the voltage of the plant also changes. So the inverter will take the data or the hint from the voltage, change in voltage, and based on that, it will change the reactive power of the system. So that is also possible, but always at the cost of active power. So it is possible to do reactive, dynamic reactive without a controller also.
Yeah, that's a good point. Does everyone agree with this?
Yeah, just as you mentioned that by voltage, it is possible to change the reactive power based on all other parameters also, like voltage, frequency, if you want to change the particular power factor or the reactive power that we are supplying to the grid, that can be possible. Or else we are also having some sort of external load managers through which we have to take the data from the load side, what is the power factor at that particular instant, then that load manager will be communicating with the inverter continuously. And as the power factor or the reactive the power factor at the grid side changes, the same command goes to the inverter to adjust the reactive power at the output. So this sort of external components also are required. Or the third thing is that we can use a AFCI, that is automatic power factor controller. Those are also available in the market, which can be directly connected at the load side. So
most of these sites would already have a
yes, those are the existing one, but when you
But I'm glad that I've heard you all out, because, and I'm very happy to see that there are solutions possible. Because how can you talk about inverters and without talking about power factor and without talking about active and reactive power? So I just wanted to bring this topic up. There's a last point, and we have only 3 minutes or 4 minutes to. Pradeep had come up with an aspect where you're using string inverters, and on top of that, you're using optimizers. I am a very strong fan. I'm a very big fan of microinverters. But I would like to know from you one by one quickly that what is coming in the way of microinverters becoming more popular, and why is it that your I don't see your brands coming out with microinverters. That's another thing that SMA, for example, I don't see them ever talking about microinverters. So quickly, can I have your views and comments on this?
See, I was also in SMA. My previous company was SMA. So SMA was having the microinverter, previously, but they then moved on. They have, you know, they moved on that product. But even now, since I'm now in Solace, so Solace is also having a collaboration with Tigo. Tigo is also providing the same. We can integrate our inverters with the Tigo that can optimize at the module level or at the string level. They can do the optimization. And in fact, optimization with respect to multiple MPPT will give you another best results. But at the same time, you have to see the market. The market is in the, you know, the initiation stage. Now, once it reaches some, you know, maturity stage, personally, I see that there will be a great demand of microinverters and optimizers. So I see at least 2 to 3 years more to reach at that maturity stage.
So just like to add a point to what my other panelists are saying. See, microinverters, DC optimizers, I relate them as cousins, you know, because they are from the same family. And then we move on to string inverters, and then we go on to multi-level container solutions or central inverters. So the it's basically more driven by markets, because these microinverters are used in those markets where you don't have much of sun, but you have a lot of demand from the market. In terms of Germany, you see there you have higher tariffs. It's one of the most mature markets, but you are not blessed with sun. India, of course, then microinverters you install in a place where you have a space constraint, and this person wants to install more power. So it's more to driven with market rather than the product. Of course, there are a lot of companies who specializes into microinverters. The moment there is a market or there is a, of course, there are a lot of products, so you will see more and more acquisitions happening in the space. So there will be bigger companies who will be acquiring these players to bring these products in their portfolio if we feel that there's a huge segment of market which we are not addressing. But as a company, as of now, I think Chint is happy to be in the space of string inverters and in central inverters.
Yes. We also have a similar point of view that comparing India and other countries where the radiation levels are different, the economic case of microinverter becomes weak in India. That is one aspect. We are right now ignoring the commercial aspects of using microinverters, their higher cost. One more aspect, which we see that in future will prevent microinverters from becoming talk of the town, will be that with more and more renewable energy getting integrated into the grid, you will see that change in the output of the solar plant will affect your grid, and you will need some kind of controllers to sometime control your solar inverters and sometimes integrate with the battery so that your grid is not destabilized. So what we are talking about here, that in future, your solar inverters will be controlled by some sort of controllers for grid stabilization. So for that to happen, microinverter is not a good case, because here for 100 kilowatt, you need to control only one device. But in a microinverter, you may need to control 50 devices, which will become a hell lot of like troublesome task. So this is one aspect. We foresee that in future, microinverters are not will be at similar pace but the market is going to go up very fast with many solar projects coming up. But larger size string inverters will be the main stakeholders in this scenario.
Yeah. So basically, as everyone said, it's basically a market related approach, and constitute in very layman language, I would say that like it is easy to handle one giant baby rather than handling 10 small crying babies. So and also, if the market is there and if we see that the trend is going towards it, then definitely many companies would move towards it. Yeah.
Yes, as per the market demand, our R&D team also is working on the optimizers, basically not on the micro inverters, but it is just for the demand. And basically, if you will see all the solar rooftop projects that are done, everything of the shadows and all the issues are already taken care of. There are very minimal cases in which there is a possibility of having a shadow on your roof. Then only it is not possible to have a good generation on that part. But basically, all the rooftop projects or the utility. If you're going for the utility, the partial shadow issue or any other issue doesn't come into existence. So for that, going for an optimizer, maybe I'm not sure how much helpful it will be. But for that, the new inverters which are coming, those are coming up with 6 MPPTs, multiple MPPTs. So they should cater the requirement, I think so.
See, we went in and adopted the optimizer technology. We went in with the optimizer technology, you know, primarily because, you know, you could maximize the capacity on the roof. A lot of places where, you know, because the roofs have not been, you know, particularly designed, thinking that solar panels would be put up on them. You know, we do see partial shading and, you know, many other issues where you sometimes see a lot of space being left on a roof just to avoid that shadowing at a particular time of the day. And that wherein we have found that we have been able to maximize. In some cases, even as high as additionally, maybe 15% or 20% more panels. Orientation has not been a constraint because only the panels which are affected are the only ones, you know, affected in the string. So we have been, you know, kind of going with north-south orientations and, you know, been pretty reasonably getting a good yield for the customers. Where we have seen a lot of industrial roofs, especially OPEX players, have, you know, not put any panel on the northern side. And, you know, we have done projects where we only got the northern side, and the southern side had already been, you know, installed by the earlier player, you know, who had done the job. So, and the yield is, obviously, there will be a difference, but it is not so impactful. So I think it is mainly, you know, from one reason is the module level monitoring offers you a very advanced level of, you know, O&M, which in Indian conditions, I feel, you know, O&M is very detrimental to the yield. You know, more than, you know, once, even if you have designed the system correctly and, you know, installed it using good BOS and everything. But we find that, you know, maintenance with time after a year or two, you know, the keenness of the customer in actually maintaining a system drops, the levels drop, casualness comes in, and that's where the yield goes down. And, you know, and like I said, the other thing is the maximizing the, you know, utilization of the roof space is where we fail. In terms of microinverters, I agree with Kishore and my other panelists that it can in the future be a problem when, you know, many people put solar systems and, you know, the grid may not be able to, and there would be systems like abroad where at times, you know, your inverters are directly controlled by the DISCOM and, you know, the power is curtailed. That might be difficult in case of microinverters, but much more easier thing to do. You know, most of the string inverters have that facility already inbuilt in them.
Okay, thank you, Pradeep. I think I'm not on the same page with you guys on the last point. We'll leave it at that, and we'll take it up some other day. On behalf of EQ and everyone else, thank you for your time, and congratulations, you finished in time. That's the most important thing.
Thank you, everyone. Quite interesting discussions on inverter technology. I'll request Mr. Vikram to present the mementos on behalf of the organizers to the speakers on stage.